Welcome back to the Island 54 Devlog. Today I'll show you how I made my game support multiplayer. So far, I've added a few crafting concepts to my game. The player can now make tools, use them to harvest resources, then construct a shelter with those resources. In this week's episode, I'll show you how I added multiplayer to my game, and then talk a bit about the difference between multiplayer and massively multiplayer. I'll finish up by responding in a bit more detail to a couple of questions I've had in the comments. As always, I've included chapter marks, and there are timestamps in the description below if you want to jump around. So how did I implement multiplayer? I want clients to establish a session with the server. They'll do this by sending any relevant parameters like username and password over HTTPS to the server. It can then send back any session parameters like the session ID, refresh frequencies, timeouts, encryption keys, and UDP endpoints. The client then starts sending regular packets over UDP, and once the server knows the client's UDP endpoint, it starts sending state updates back. Now, to get this episode out on time, I decided to simplify things a little for now by just sending JSON blobs around. Instead of the client sending control events, I made it just serialize the characters in current transform. Instead of the server sending a combination of differential and snapshot updates, I just made it repeatedly send an entire snapshot of all of its state. It's not very efficient, but it made pretty good proof of concept. I decided to implement my server in TypeScript, as it lets me very quickly test changes, and I'm pretty familiar with the JavaScript language family. I needed the server to maintain two pieces of state for now, the current sessions and the managed entities. I went with Redux to hold the state because it makes writing and testing the code really easy. It would be a terrible solution from an MMO because it is restricted to one thread updating the state. The shape of the state looked like this. We index the active sessions by their ID and store important information like UDP endpoint, when we last saw them, and any data waiting to be read for processing or sent out to the client. Entities just store transform information for now, but I will want to introduce the concept of components later on. The server has both a web service and a UDP listener. The web service is responsible for processing requests for new sessions. Whenever a datagram is received, it validates it and stores it against the session for later processing. The server runs a tick every 100 milliseconds. In each tick, it executes each of its configured systems. A system in this design is just a function that will go off and process any bits of state it's responsible for. I only have two systems for now, a reader, which processes any pending client messages, and a writer, which serializes all the entities ready to be sent to the clients. After running the systems, it then runs through each of its active sessions and either sends any messages waiting to go out, or removes them if they've timed out. That brings us to the client side of things. I needed a proper menu system to test out the multiplayer features properly, so I created a new scene and created a main menu and multiplayer menu. When a player creates either a single or multiplayer game, it loads the demo game scene, optionally passing it the relevant server configuration. The server manager script is responsible for maintaining the session and keeping local game objects in sync with the remotely managed entities. The session script sends the request for the new session and handles timeouts. If the session enters an error state, we just throw the old session away and request a new one. On each frame, the server manager currently serializes the player's transform and sends it off. This results in 6 messages being sent to the server for every tick, but other than being inefficient, shouldn't have any negative consequences. Any time a message is received from the server, it saves it for later processing on the main thread. To process it, it enumerates the remote entities, ignores the state update for its own player, and creates a game object if needed and updates transform. Running the game on both my PC and my laptop, you can see that while it's a little bit jittery, it works just fine. I still have a lot of work to do to get this up to scratch. Most importantly, I need to move more state to the server. Things like the terrain, stones, and trees are still stored on the client and aren't being shared properly. I also need to start sending differential data and ensure that packets aren't getting too big. I'll do a lot of that kind of thing behind the scenes over the next few weeks. Making a multiplayer game really isn't that hard. With just a week's work, I have it at a stage where it mostly works, albeit a bit inefficiently and with some rough edges. So what's so hard about making a massively multiplayer game? This is ultimately a question of scalability. To support thousands of clients, you need to run the game across multiple servers. I understand this is achieved in many MMOs through a technique called sharding. Basically, you make each server responsible for a piece of the world. Each server owns and manages its own piece of independent state. As a character moves around the world, they get shunted from one server to another behind the scenes. I think an alternative approach might be to treat the server like a modern cloud system. Rather than breaking up the world according to in-game coordinates, I think it might be possible to break it up by function. You'd have a scalable cluster of servers just responsible for constructing packets for the clients. Another cluster might be responsible for inventory, another for combat, another for mob AI, and so on. To properly support this though, you need to treat the game logic and data a bit like the comms going over UDP. You need to be resilient to nodes disappearing while processing an event. You need to handle events being processed multiple times, and you need to handle state updates occurring out of order. I've decided this is an area I'm interested in exploring, so instead of trying to find ways of reducing the scope of this game, I'm going to continue along assuming this is going to be a massively multiplayer game and gradually work on solving the architectural challenges that this will present to me. Next up, I want to respond to a couple of comments that have come in over the past week. I guess it's sort of comments plural of the week. Zephyr Cool writes, "Will there be terraforming / mining? I'd love the game to support both underground mining in mineshafts and open cut mining like quarries. I don't want it to be like Minecraft where you can dig out massive caverns in next to no time. It should be a slow, risky, and rewarding process. Perhaps something defends the more resource-rich areas, so players are encouraged to band together to mine safely. A potential issue with mining, especially in an MMO, is that you don't want the landscape around the populated areas to start resembling Swiss cheese. One mechanic I've thought a bit about is one where mine shafts gradually revert over time, making mined resources effectively renewable, but allowing the game to control scarcity of resources by manipulating the rate at which mines revert. As for terraforming, I'd like to work on something pretty soon for the purpose of base construction. It should be possible to flatten an area of ground within a land claim, for example. Next up is Noah Wood, who asks, "Are you planning to publish this game, and is it going to be free?" I spoke a bit in the first episode about why I'm making a devlog, but not why I want to make a game. There are two main reasons I'm making a game. Firstly, I want to be able to make a living making products I'm passionate about. And secondly, I want to make a great game that can give people many hours of enjoyment. So to answer your question, I definitely plan to publish this game. It's going to take me a while to get there, but I'd hate to put all this effort in and not have anyone be able to play it. I would absolutely love as many people as possible to be able to play the game for free. I don't know what that will look like though. If I were making a game in a week, I'd happily give it away for free and maybe accept donations. But if I'm going to spend a year or so making an MMO that needs infrastructure to run, maybe a free-to-play model would be more appropriate. Let me know in the comments down below what you think is a good model that lets as many people play as possible while balancing the need to make a living. With that out of the way, I'm keen to hear what you lot would like to see me work on next. Now, if you enjoyed this episode, don't forget to leave a like. If you didn't enjoy it but watched to the end anyway, be sure to leave a mean comment down below. And until next time, happy game developing.